I'm Sebastian St. James. Your retirement is going to suck because you didn't try hard enough. You could be sipping on Dom Perignon while watching your staff do the housework. But instead you're sucking on a cask while pushing the Hoover. Can investing borrowed money using leverage make that much of a difference? To find out, I have created a massive Monte Carlo simulation that will answer this question. I have crunched the numbers, I have optimized the algorithmic oscillators, and today we will find out for sure. I have taken 65.1 years of Australian mortgage rates, and I've taken the historical rates of the S&P 500 in Australian dollars, and I've combined them like a Power Ranger. Today we're asking the question, can investment returns pay for the mortgage interest? There is something about the S&P 500 you need to know. What is it? I don't see it. Oh, it's total return. Total return means stock price plus dividends, and from that, you'll pay your loan interest. But what do I mean by pay? Will the dividends cover the loan repayments? Well, that would make sense. But you tell your bank manager that you've stopped making payments because you've used up all your dividends. And see what happens. My simulation assumes you invest your dividends back into the market, hence total return. You make your loan repayments from this invested pool. You're paying from dividends first. You're investing any leftover dividends, and you're selling shares when necessary. Oh, I just got a thanks, and this one requires a fanfare. It's a pay ID from Elmo. Wow. And he says, advance thanks. Thank you very much, Elmo. A huge, huge thanks to you. I very much appreciate that. Thanks and channel memberships push your questions to the top of the queue. And that's how you get a video made answering your questions. My Monte Carlo simulation takes real historical data. Interest rates and stock market returns are consistently sampled from the same dates. This means that we're sampling Australians' actual lived experiences. This actually happened. It's time to look at the actual results of my simulation, but which results should we look at first? This is my latest channel member, G4. Whoa, hang on, Sebastian. Why are your other channel members supermodels? Whereas G4 is made out of clay. Firstly, that is very classist of you. I expect better. And secondly, that's what G4 looks like in real life. Some people get all the bad luck. And if you're one of them, you know that you'll be sat next to a screaming baby on a flight every time. G4 was born without any legs. And there's nothing wrong with that. Not all clay people have legs. But G4 assumes that if he borrowed against his clay house, he would get the worst outcome. So what is the worst outcome in our Monte Carlo simulation? Oh, here's the setup. We borrow $50,000 in an interest-only loan, and we added $50,000 of our own. We start at $100,000. At a quarter of the way through, we have $15,400 left. What's happened to my $100,000? Halfway through, we are minus $21,900. Three quarters of the way through 15 years, we have minus $76,200. My kids aren't getting fed this week. And the final figure at the end of 15 years is minus $114,000. What do I mean by minus? How do stocks even go minus? Well, they don't. When I show you a negative figure like this, it means you borrowed $50,000. You deducted interest payments from your investment balance while stocks last. And then you made up the shortfall from your own pocket, which was $114,000. Oh, I just got a thanks from Mr. Steve OC via Pay ID. Hanging on till I see your review of Member Direct. Thank you, Mr. Steve. What a lovely surprise. Not only does that push Mr. Steve's questions further up the queue, but closer to seeing the video on Member Direct. Whoa! You have discovered an important rule of Investing Club. The first rule of Investing Club is you do not talk about Investing Club. If you only invest your own money, that is the most you can lose. If you borrow to invest, you can lose that many times over. You can lose what you borrowed, but you still have to keep paying interest. And you still have to repay back the capital because it was an interest-only loan. So far, we have seen the worst outcome in our simulation, but that's only 1 in 400 chance. Okay, let's get rid of the outliers. If I invest personally, what is the worst of the more likely results? The more likely result is the middle 80%, which is between the 10th and the 90th percentiles. This is the 10th percentile, which means it's the worst of the more likely results, which ends up with minus 12,500, which means you had to pay that. But don't forget, you still have to pay back the $50,000 that wasn't a part of the simulation. Wow, okay, this happened after we threw out the outliers, and we still went broke. We started with 50,000, we borrowed another 50, and the final balance was minus 12,500. And we still have to pay back the loan, so that's another minus 50. And so you ended up with minus 62,500. And they are additional funds that you had to pay. Right, let's calculate the return on investment, which is minus 225%. Oh, I just got some thanks from Elmo. Thank you very much, Elmo. Elmo is Australia's leading expert on my videos, which I think makes him a national treasure. There is a powerful technique known only to retirees that can guarantee you'll never lose money. Oh, putting your money in the bank. Losing money in an investment is a type of failure you always have to factor in. I spent considerable time reprogramming my Monte Carlo simulation, so from here on in, we can detect at the same time multiple types of failure. This is the going broke failure, which is a failure rate of 13%. We lost money 125 times, meaning we ended up less than what we started with, which is a lost money rate of 31.2%. So there is your answer. Based on the data of our simulation, borrowing against your house to invest in shares, you had a 68.8% chance of profiting. However, if you're investing your own money, your chance of profiting is 100%. Except, that's not true. You can lose money on the stock market even if you're strictly investing your own money. Not going broke and not losing money at all are two very different things. But TJ would have none of this. You don't fancy a panic with borrowed wire, mate. Who's TJ? It's my latest channel member, TJ Hills. TJ says, anybody who goes into hock to make a few quid should have their head red. And so he demands to see a comparison. What comparison? What if you took $50,000 of your own money and invested that in stocks? No borrowing, no leverage, all pure profit. Ooh, interesting. And here is a simulation. Firstly, there's no borrowing. And we start with 50k rather than 100k because, well, we didn't borrow. And this is approved by Hereford Cows. Well, that's good to know, TJ. If you invested your own money using exactly the same data as we did in the simulation before, head to head, would you go broke? Here is a comparison. Borrow and invest versus just invest in the same thing. Both 400 runs using exactly the same data. If you borrowed, you went broke 52 times. Invest in your own money, zero. Does including leverage make your investment more risky? Well, clearly, yes. If you borrowed, your failure rate was 13%. With your own money, zero. If you borrowed, you lost money 125 times. With your own money, only five. Which is a loss rate of 31.2% or 1.25%. Wow, that's hardly any. The data is clear. Borrowing to invest is riskier than using just your own money. But how much riskier? Well, they're the actual figures, making borrowing 25 times riskier. But Terry won't hear of this. She says that leverage must work, otherwise people wouldn't be using it. And as a self-made woman, she believes in making her own luck. It's my brand new channel member, Terry Feltham. How lucky could Terry get if she did use leverage? Here are the two portfolios again. Terry is borrowing, so she's got the top one. A quarter of the way through, well, Terry's in front, $300,000. At the halfway mark, Terry, wow, you almost doubled. And she ended up with $3.27 million versus $2.25 million if she invested her own money. And of course, she still has to pay back the $50,000. Proving that leverage does work, at least in extreme cases. Oh, I just got a thanks from JPad via PayID. Thank you. And thank you, JPad. You are definitely my favourite type of pad. Oh, he's asked me a question. Thanks, SSJ. Amazing video. However, I'm a little confused. P.S. How can we tip you to explain this, J? Okay. Request granted. Can you please explain specifically the currency risk of owning NDQ or Triple Q? NDQ and Triple Q are NASDAQ ETFs. Triple Q, an American fund quoted in American dollars. NDQ, an Australian fund quoted in Australian dollars. Ah, you say, different currencies, different currency risks. But you'd be wrong. On day one, for every US dollar, you get two Australian dollars. Right, so if the Triple Qs were valued at 500 US dollars, that's 1,000 in Australian dollars. At the same time, NDQ, which is valued at 500 US, oh, so it's the same amount, is 1,000 in Australian dollars. Oh, how interesting. So even though NDQ is quoted in Australian dollars, it's still the same US value. On day two, the currencies have changed. Oh, it's now one for one. Triple Q is still worth 500 US dollars, which is 500 Australian dollars now. And NDQ, which is still worth 500 US dollars, but it's quoted in Australian dollars, is now 500 Australian dollars.
Yes!
Both ETFs track the same US index, and so they're affected in the same way by currency swings. Then he talks about market timing, and he thinks he's actually purchasing from another investor. When you buy either of these ETFs, you are buying on the secondary market. Your shares are probably years old, so I wouldn't put them in a bread mix because they probably won't rise. And do ETFs have an IPO process so that they can grow their funds? There are super beings that are the only ones that ETFs will ever deal with. Oh, here they are. Who are these people? Oh, they're authorized participants, large institutions. This is how ETF shares are created. The NAV of NDQ right now is $40. But you don't know this because you watch too much Netflix, so you bid $50. Greedy Frank, who's an authorized participant, wants in on this action. Frank gives NDQ stocks that the ETF wants to hold or cash. NDQ creates new shares for Frank at $40. And Frank sells his overpriced shares to you for $50. The next day, your wife wants to divorce you. And so you're forced to sell everything. NDQ is still worth $40. You're desperate to sell because you gave your secretary a back rub. So you ask $30. Big Frank buys your shares at $30. Frank then redeems his shares for $40, and NDQ gives him back his cash or stocks. And then NDQ destroys the shares. And it's all your fault that Big Frank is rich. The time has come to reveal all the data. In reality, are you more likely to do better investing your own money or to use leverage? In green, we have the 90th percentile. That's your best case scenario if you throw out the outliers. Median is bang in the middle. And the 10th percentile is your worst if you throw out the outliers. Well, they all start off the same. At the quarter mark, borrowing to investors, clearly the winner. Halfway in, okay, it's getting closer. The median outcome is still better if you borrowed. But in the worst case, for the first time, borrowing's actually doing worse. At the three-quarter mark, ha, look at that. Borrowing to invest is 160,000. If you didn't borrow, you'd be 173. In other words, you'd be doing better. And the final figures are astounding. Best case, leverage beats non-leverage, but not by much. In the worst case, non-leveraged beat leveraged, and leveraged went broke. And for the median return, non-leveraged beat leveraged, 257,000 versus 199. If we look across the entire 15 years, the longer you held your portfolio, leverage performed worse over time relative to the non-leveraged. Oh, I just got a thanks from Terry. Thanks, Sebastian, learning lots. Thank you very much, Terry. That was lovely. I still have some more people to thank, and that I will do in my next video. But I have some questions. How do taxes and fees change the rate of failure? How does negative gearing affect the outcome? If I paid for the loan from my income instead of using invested capital, what difference would that make? What if I never borrowed, but instead took the amount I would have paid in loan repayments and invested that in the market? Which is the questions Elmo wants to know. What is the answer to these questions? Well, I'm not allowed to tell you. Because they will be answered in part 3, coming soon. There is one place you can't borrow, and that's within your Australian super fund, where index funds are king. Which one should I go for? Click here to find out, or if you've seen that, click here.